So ends Herman Melville's allegory, The Man's Challenge of God's Will. Moby Dick, produced, directed by John Huston. I hope it grabbed you. It certainly did me here. Picture was made three times. It was made back in 1926 and again in 30 with John Barrymore. But in those versions, they had ladies. Imagine that, ladies in this very masculine tale. Dolores Costello, I believe, was the first, and Joan Bennett. How about that? Now we go, ladies and gentlemen, to a very few TV Ontario highlights. Now, an interview with the man who made Moby Dick, John Huston. Interviewed, incidentally, 9 years ago here. Now, the late, of course, John Huston. An actor, he was tremendous as an actor in, of course, Chinatown. And as a screenwriter, who could beat him when he wrote Jezebel and Sergeant York? We know him best as a director, don't we? Of the Maltese Falcon, the Treasure of Sierra Madre, the Asphalt Jungle, African Queen, Moulin Rouge, the man who would be king, and here he is.
Moby Dick offered the biggest set of problems. It was done during an unholy winter. I suppose it was called the worst winter in English history, in that section of water between Ireland and Fishguard, Wales, the open Atlantic.
Wild.
And rescue boats, these are good-sized motor launches, went to the bottom, and we were on our way to the bottom three times, I thought. We were dismasted three times.
Really?
Yes. And once there was no question about it. We were shipwrecked, and saved by just masterful seamanship.
You got into the whale once, didn't you? You and a bottle of whiskey, I think you describe it. That must have been a wild ride, because you were towed, weren't you?
The whale was towed, and there would occur every now and then. The opportunity for a choice between whether to save the whale or the men in the longboats, and we were disposed humanely to save the men. So, and we'd lose the whale. The cable would be separated, and the whale would be lost at sea in the storm. And these whales were very valuable, but not simply the immediate value of the whale, the fact that we wouldn't be able to shoot when we lost a whale. And it would take weeks to rebuild a whale. Well, we built two whales. We lost two. And never expecting to, of course. After we lost the second, it was pretty desperate. And we had, finally a third was built, and the same situation occurred. And this time I was sure that they wouldn't forsake me, their director, if I got into the whale. They wouldn't let the whale go if I got inside it. So I did. It happened to be New Year's Day or New Year's Eve.
Dear Lord.
And I had a bottle of whiskey, and I saluted the
old out of the new year.
All the people around in other boats and disappeared into the whale. They saved the whale. They got it.
John Huston, was this the first time he'd ever worked with Orson Welles? Because he plays the minister at the beginning, doesn't he?
Yes, it was the first time.
How was he as a man to work with? Did he take direction well, or?
Well, I can tell you a little story
all
about
right.
that if you'd like to hear
yes,
it.
Yes, I'd love to hear it.
I sent Orson the script to Paris, and he did some rewriting himself on it and sent it back to me, and he had improved it considerably. So the day came to shoot it. It was a long scene. He had to climb into the pulpit. It was the the minister was an ex-sea captain.
Father Mapple.
Mapple. And he climbs into the pulpit up a rope ladder. And there are discourses to the congregation. And there's a long scene, 6 or 8 pages of solid sermon. And Orson standing in the pulpit, all made up and looking wonderful. He's riffled through those pages. And I said, "Should we have a rehearsal?" And Orson said, "John, I've never been so nervous. I don't know what's the matter with me. I've got stage fright." "Could I have a drink? Could I have a drink of brandy?" So I sent out for a bottle of brandy, and Orson put it in the pulpit. Had a drink, but in the pulpit. And I said, "Well, whenever you're ready, Orson, we'll have a rehearsal." And he said, "Let's just shoot it. Let's try it. Let's run at it.
Yeah.
Let's take a run at it." I said, "All right." And the cameras began to turn over. And we shot the scene. He was letter perfect, comma perfect.
Oh.
And one of the best performances, not only he ever gave, but that I've ever seen. And the scene had been scheduled for, I think, 2 days or 3 days. We finished it that morning. He ran through it perfectly 3 times, which was all we needed.
That's incredible. What a pro, but nervous.
Well, I think there was a little acting in that, too. I think he dramatized the moment.
But, of course, the late, great John Huston. We go now to the man John Huston picked, the curious choice, to write the screenplay for Moby Dick, because this man is identified almost completely with science fiction. Ray Bradbury is his name, and his screen credits include It Came from Outer Space and Fahrenheit 451 and The Illustrated Man and Something Wicked This Way comes under a credit of original author. He was a delight. His home is deliciously eccentric. The man himself, a beautiful guy, and here he is.
I gave all my books to John Huston on Valentine's night, 1951, and I published 3 books, The Illustrated Man, Martian Chronicles, and Dark Carnival, and I had dinner with him that night. I arranged dinner, and I gave him the books. I said, "It's very simple. I love you, and I love your film, and someday I want to work with you, so take the books with you." He was going to Africa the next week, and he wrote me back from Africa and said, "Yes, someday, I agree with you. We'll work together, God knows on what."
African Queen, right?
African Queen. And so I didn't hear from him. We wrote back and forth twice in three years. And in August of 1953, he called me on the phone and invited me to his hotel, put a drink in my hand, and looked down my face and said, "Well, Ray, what are you doing during the next year?" And I said, "Gee, Mr. Huston, not much." He says, "Well, how'd you like to come? I'll live in Ireland, and write the screenplay of Moby Dick." And I said, "Gee, Mr. Huston, I've never been able to read the damn thing." So there was a long pause, and then he says, "Well, tell you what, Ray, why don't you go home tonight, read as much as you can, and come back tomorrow. Tell me if you'll help me
as much as you
kill the white whale." So I went home that night, and I said to my wife, "Pray for me." And she said, "Why?" I said, "Because I've got to read a book tonight and do a book report tomorrow." So I read as much as I could and went back the next day and took the job. And when I was working in Ireland with Huston, I said to him, "How did I get this job?" And he said, "It was that short story of yours about the dinosaur falling in love with the lighthouse." He read it in one of my books, and also in Saturday Evening Post, The Foghorn, The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms.
Oh, that's the movie.
Yeah, and so he thought he smelled the ghost of Melville there, and what he smelled was the ghost of the Bible and Shakespeare that I was raised on. And
that's the thing I wanted to hear.
Yeah, those are the midwives of Moby Dick.
Yes.
Most people don't realize that Melville never read Shakespeare until he was 30, because books in Melville's time were printed in small type. So if you had weak eyes, you couldn't read it. You had to have it read to you. And when Melville was 30, he went to Boston, found an edition in large type, and ran amok with Shakespeare. And in the next few months, he wrote Moby Dick. So the first midwife is partially the Bible. The second big midwife is Shakespeare. And those are my midwives. So that's what Shakespeare, that's what Huston recognized when he read my story.
In the Foghorn.
The Foghorn,
yes,
yeah.
And, yes. And he got, well, goodness me, I have read, and I don't want to intrude in your private life too much, Rick, mm-hmm. but that it was one of the most depressing experiences of your life, and I'm wondering how that could have been, because to me, it would seem to have been the most, one of the most glorious triumphs.
Well,
it's a great screenplay, by the way, Ray.
Well, thank you. Well, it was such a huge responsibility. It was my first screenplay, you see, and here I was working for two heroes, Melville, I'd fallen in love with the book, and my superhero, John Huston. When people used to write me 38 years ago and say, when are you going to do a screenplay? And I always responded, when John Huston asks.
Oh, you really?
So he was my hero. So I got to Ireland. I kept reading the book, and I felt dumb all the time because it was so difficult. And I was depressed all the time because I didn't want to fail John Huston. And so he let me alone for the first 6 weeks. He's a very smart man. And he let me do the first 50, 55 pages of the screenplay. Just before Thanksgiving, I had 55 pages to give to him, and I went out to his big house outside of Dublin and out in near Kilcock, and I turned in the pages. I said, John, it's very simple. Today is the day you hire or fire me forever. I don't want to keep on working if I'm not doing good work. So you read the script now in the next few hours, and then 3 hours from now you tell me if you want me to continue. Otherwise, I'll pack up the family tomorrow and go home, because I'm not one of those people to take the money and run, huh? If I'm failing you, fire me. She said, okay, kid, go upstairs and take a nap, and I'll call you in a couple hours. So 2 hours later, I tried to sleep up there, and of course I couldn't. But finally I heard the most beautiful words I've ever heard in my life. John Huston calling up the stairs and saying, Ray, kid, come down and finish the screenplay.
Oh.
Well, coming down the stairs, I wept, you know. And then the depression fell away. I realized I'd been living under such a tension for 6 weeks. I was suicidal, really. It was just terrible. And from then on, it was difficult. But at least I was relaxed at last, and we were able to make these changes.
So some people have maintained, and I read a little bit of Moby Dick, I've never finished it, that it was like unwritable as a screenplay, like nobody could really do it.
Well, what you've got to do with any book, even the simplest one, you've got to read it so many months on end. Some books for 3 months on end, others for six. In the case of Moby Dick, I read it again and again, some parts 100 times, for 7 months. At the end of the 7th month in London, on a single day, I got out of bed one morning. I looked in the mirror and I said, I am Herman Melville. And on that day, I wrote 1/4 of the screenplay. 30 pages, boom, all came out. But it was that magical day when I was Herman Melville. And that's what screenwriting is. If you're going to adapt someone else, you can't float over it. You've got to dive in it and drown, huh? And then be reborn in the material.
Oh, yeah. Whoa,
and thank God for that day. Because I ran across London in a fever, and I threw the script into John's lap, and I said, there, I think we're done. And he read it, and he says, yes, we are. Huh? But that was a great day, great day.
Ray Bradbury, tell us a little bit about the relationship with Huston, working on the screenplay and what happened to the screenplay and so on.
I believe
there's a story there.
Well, it's black and white and light and dark, a combination, because John was such a sort of person that could romance people. He could make you fall in love. Just Peckinpah had the same ability, you know. I talked to Peckinpah once years ago. I said, how do you get your films made? He says, I make people fall in love with me. I said, I believe it, because he was a real sweet guy, and he could be a monster, you know, and he suddenly changed. But I'll give you a good example of how John could win you over to his side. I was at dinner one night with a whole bunch of guests from Dublin and London out of his big house outside of Dublin, and John started telling a story. He said, I want to tell you a story about a dinosaur falling in love with
I love it.
And, you know, the dinosaur swims through the deeps, and here's the foghorn blowing, you know. And when he finished telling the story, he pointed to the far end of the table. He says, and that story, my friend, was written
by that young man down there,
and he points to me, and the whole table turns, and I'm blushing, you know, and I'm so happy, you know.
I'm
madly in love with John Huston forever, you know. And then later, he does things which cripple you temporarily, you know, very unhappy things. Well, at lunch, 8 weeks later, with some strangers, all of a sudden at lunch, I'm sitting there in a restaurant in Dublin, and John suddenly says, out of nowhere, he says, I've got this terrible feeling that Ray doesn't have his heart at his work. I said, gee. I dropped my soup spoon in the, and I couldn't eat the rest of the lunch, you know.
That's a terrible thing to me.
Yeah, and I didn't know these people were with, you know. And I couldn't speak the rest of the lunchtime. I had to stop myself from crying. And we got back to the hotel, and he said goodbye to friends. He came up to my room for a meeting on the script, and he looked in my face. He says, kid, what's wrong? I said, John, what was that about at lunch? Huh? He said, oh, Ray, that was a joke. I said, a joke? My God, you know, and I burst into tears. Then he ran over and put his arms around me. He said, Ray, it was a joke. I said, you know, no more jokes, huh? No more jokes like that.
Some joke.
I can't take it. So that was a minor thing, you know, minor thing. And we got back together, and I went on with the screenplay. But he had this way with people at times. Late at night, it turned into a short story later for me. We'd be sitting around the fire talking, you know. And he'd play cards with his friends, and I'd stay on till midnight for another meeting about the script. And one night, very late, he was sitting by the fire there, and he looked over at me and says, you know, Ray, one of the problems is you don't love me as much as I love you. I said, oh, come on, John, I do so. And he's always getting you to protest your love. And I don't think you do that well. I said, and then a moment later, he listened. He said, did you hear that, Ray? I said, what do you mean? Outside, just now, in the night. That wasn't the wind. You know what that was, Ray? That was a banshee. A banshee outside. And I tell you what, Ray, why don't you take my coat and go out and see if it was. I said, no, I don't want to go outside. Oh, don't be yellow, kid. Don't be yellow. I don't want a coward here in the house.
I believe it.
And I refused to go out, of course. And then later, I turned it into a short story, and it was on my series on television 2 years ago with Peter O'Toole playing John Huston, the banshee story. That's a true story.
Oh,
all the dialogue and
God,
everything in that story happened that night, except the ending. I didn't go out to see the banshee, and nor did I make John go out. But that 80% of that story is our true dialogue, yeah. So that's the kind of guy he was. I never figured him out. I don't think he ever figured himself out. I don't think he ever understood himself. There are people like that who can't accept their own talent and their own genius.
Screenplay, though, I think he took some credit on that, and I'm wondering how valid that is.
Well, it's a very sad story. I worked on it, you know, for 7-8 months, and I was incredibly grateful. I mean, it really turned my life around forever. Since that time, I've never had to go begging for work. So on that part of it, I'll be grateful to the end of my life. But the irony is, when I finished my work the last day in London, and I was ready to leave for Italy, where my family was waiting for me, I said to Huston that last day, John, I'm so grateful. I would like you to share credit on the screenplay with me. And he said, no, kid. It's your screenplay. You just won credit. You get that. I said, no, I'm very serious. You know, I'm so grateful. He said, no, that's it. So,
well, you've written it.
But I'd read it, but like a fool, I offered him half the credit.
Well, you're so grateful.
And sure, and then he didn't accept it, so that was the end of it. And 2 years later, when the film was about to come out, I got a notice from Warner Brothers saying the credit will read John Huston and Ray Bradbury on the screenplay.
John Huston and Ray.
Yeah, so I was terribly upset, and I called. The first ads came out. I've got them here in the basement somewhere. And the first ad that came out on Moby Dick, you'll see my name is there alone, okay? And he went to the Writers Guild, and there was a trial, and they read the script, and I won. So my name remained on the film and the script for at least 4 more months. Then he came back and said, no, this isn't fair. I want another trial, which was against the law of the Writers Guild, not allowed. And he then took a copy of my script with my name on it and marked it with red pencil and offered it as his evidence. And the people who judged read his treatise and looked at my script with his marks on it and said, well, if this weren't a famous director, we would have no worries about this, but since he is, he's going to share the credit. Well, I was paranoid for a month after that.
That's right.
I was very upset. And the film came out, and the double credit is there. And I've tried, in fact, this is the very first time I've ever talked about it on television.
Well, I hope it makes you feel better.
Let me add this final thing. 2 years ago, I was in a restaurant in Beverly Hills, and across the way I saw John Huston sitting with friends, Jack Nicholson, a couple other people. And when lunch was over, I walked over to him and shook hands. I hadn't seen him in 20 years. And I turned to everyone at the table. I says, I want to make a little speech here because I'll never have the chance again. And I said, this man changed my life forever, all for the good. I'm eternally grateful, and I wanted to thank him in front of witnesses. And then I shook John's hand and walked away. So that was my last encounter with him. So it's a perfect ending to a happiness here, a happiness there, and some trouble in between.
And that was the legendary Ray Bradbury, the famous science fiction writer who wrote the screenplay for our movie tonight, Moby Dick. Return to Hollywood now for a few interviews with a few people concerning John Huston and Gregory Peck, our star of the evening. Donald Photo is here, the noted author, and Leonard Maltin of Entertainment Tonight, a very fine film commentator. Plus that fine film historian and author, Tony Thomas, who's been here many, many times, and a very current director. He made 48 Hours and a very fine one indeed, Walter Hill.
I think John Huston's reputation has grown in recent years. It's not just his death that has caused people to look back. I think in the latter years of his life, people took a second look at John Huston and said, wait a minute, this is not someone to take for granted. Now, he was never taken for granted in the sense that his films weren't seen. He had a lot of great, great hits. But he had a sort of a fallow period there.
Yes, he did.
In the 60s and 70s when he made a lot of clinkers. And a lot of films where he just seemed to be going through the motions. And maybe he was. But he came out of it. His last few films were really extraordinary.
Into The Dead.
The Dead, Christie's Honor.
Yes.
Some really fine work there.
Man
Wise Blood.
Man Who Would Be King.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Good, good filmmaking. Mm-hmm. And I think that caused people to say, this is no ordinary filmmaker. This is a man who has something special to say.
Huston and I socially got along quite well. I liked him. He's a very engaging fellow. I saw him quite a bit in the last year before he died. He was up in Laurel Canyon. I used to go to visit John. We were talking about a project that I had done a script on and he had done a script on. And he couldn't direct it, and I was thinking about directing it. It didn't have it. His movie subsequently been made, but
what is the movie, or is that immaterial?
No, the movie is from the James Harrison novella. It's called Revenge. It hasn't come out yet. It's been shot in the last year. And Huston and I, like I say, we had some very fine moments together, and a lot of nice lunches and dinners and things like that. He and I disagreed about the project that was at hand. It was a novel called The Freedom Trap. I didn't think that the story was all that good, and I thought it should be changed a lot. He wanted to stick to the book, and it then came to pass that I was fired from the project. Several other writers came on, and then eventually John really wrote most of it himself. He subsequently kind of complained, I know, about the script and it never got right, but
I guess that's too bad. The picture didn't do that well.
Well, no, it was a lousy movie. You know, there's no reason it should have done.
Yeah.
I don't think John ever got it. It was a lousy movie. But I think that like I said, there were a number of writers involved on the thing. I ended up getting sole screen credit because I think I had written more than anybody else. But I think that, you know, directors really should be remembered and thought about for the best films, mm-hmm. and not the worst films.
That's right.
And if you do this for a few years, and I haven't really done it that many years, but I can tell you that, you see, if you make films with the best intentions and with scripts that you think are very good and cast that you think are proper for the parts and the and a reasonable amount of money to get it done properly, they can still go very wrong, mm-hmm. just for chemical reasons. Sometimes the script that reads well, you know, Howard Hawks always said that beware of a script that reads well. Nothing more dangerous. But the script that reads well sometimes doesn't play well. An actor that you think off previous work might be right for a part turns out not to be. You know, this is a form that's very different than other creative endeavors, because if you're a painter or you're a novelist or something like that, you can take a few months. If you don't like what you're doing, you can put it in the drawer or put it in the closet. We go out there, and every day that we shoot, you've got to be prepared to live the rest of your life with what you shoot. The financial burden is so great that you have to work quickly, and you're committing it to what's going to be the movie. And if it doesn't work properly for whatever reason, and there are and you are bringing together a lot of different factors, you're stuck with it. And like I say, I don't think that it's finally very productive. You talk about Macintosh Man, you know, it was a bad movie. John Huston made, and it was probably not a very terrific script by me, and it didn't get to be a better script, I don't think, by the other people, but Huston made 3, 4, 5 very fine films, and a number of other films that were quite good, and I think that you can probably argue that almost every significant director has made at least a couple of very bad movies. Mm-hmm. I think that's the nature of the game.
As you may know, Moby Dick has been done a number of times. There were 2 versions of John Barrymore done in the silent days. And then Huston had this in mind for many, many years, and he wanted to use his father, Walter Huston, as Ahab. Mm-hmm. That was his plan. But Walter died, and then Warner Brothers picked up the property, and they insisted that Gregory Peck star in it in order to give it name value and box office mm-hmm. viability, mm-hmm. which didn't please Peck very much. What he wanted to play was Starbuck. He would have been much more suited to that.
Oh, I didn't realize that. No.
And he is not very comfortable as Ahab and knows it.
Who played it, by the way? Basehart?
Basehart played Starbuck
in the film.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. But he wanted to get Walter. That was
yes, well, that was the idea.
Yeah.
Now, in talking to Gregory Peck about this, he says that the man who should have played Ahab in that version was John Huston himself. He was more Ahabian by nature than any other actor he knew of. But that should have been the modus operandi, was Huston directing himself as Ahab.
That's a fascinating
Instead thought. Of Gregory Peck looking like Abe Lincoln at sea.
Gregory Peck is, to me, one of the finest actors in the history of American film. Not often appreciated. Very often appreciated, but not often enough celebrated. Gregory Peck stands for a kind of decency and vulnerability that was never weakness. When we look at, from his earliest films, The Keys of the Kingdom, Spellbound, just those two in the 1940s when he was a Selznick contract player, we never had any doubt that Gregory Peck was and could be a romantic leading man, darkly attractive. But there was nothing simplistic about him. He could portray vulnerability throughout his career, and decency and tenderness, and show that they were consistent with strength. He gave in Keys of the Kingdom and Spellbound, as in so many later films, he gave an astonishing portrait. He was a man of valor, and I might add, he's that in private life as well. He's a man of valor and of concern without making it seem wishy-washy or unreal. I think Gregory Peck is one of the most astonishing exponents of strong decency that we have in American film. I admire him greatly.
And with those interviews, we wrap up another session here on Saturday Night at the Movies. Hope you enjoyed the theme we explored, The Archie Blows and Moby Dick, and of course, John Huston and Ray Bradbury and the other guests. See you next week, ladies and gentlemen, same time, same channel, for another session right here. Bye for now.